Aye.
I, Freda Prempeh.
Swear by the Almighty God.
Swear by the Almighty God.
That the evidence I shall give before this committee.
That the evidence I shall give before this committee.
Touching the matter in issue.
Touching the matter in issue.
Shall be the truth.
Shall be the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Honorable Freda, Ohinafro Agosia Prempeh, on behalf of the committee, I congratulate you on your nomination as Deputy Minister for Works and Housing. The practice is that you tell us about yourself briefly. After that, we will ask you questions on your CV. I recall that in the Ninth Parliament. No, yes, the Ninth Parliament. Okay. Was the Ninth Parliament? No, no. This is seventh. So the Fifth Parliament, Professor Amia Kofi behind you was the one in charge of that exercise, taking everybody through his CV. So being behind you, I'm sure you allowed him to vet your CV before. Otherwise, other people who have succeeded him will vet your CV. So please tell us about yourself.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I'm Freda Prempeh. I come from Duyankwanta and Yamfo. Honorable Harina is a friend to Yamfo community. My father comes from Yamfo, my mother comes from Duyankwanta, both in the Tano district. Mr. Chairman, I started my primary education at the University Primary School, Kumasi, from 1978 to 1983. And then I proceeded to the then Technology Secondary School, which is now Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, to pursue my O levels. I finished in 1983. Mr. Chairman, we have a very interesting family record. Right from O levels, whether you like it or not, as we affectionately called our mom, Commander Hill, you have to go and serve 1 year national service with her in Sunyani to support her run her business. All of us, eight of us, we all did our 1 year family national service with her. But fortunately or unfortunately for me, I served about 7 years with her because she wanted me to assist her run the business. So from 1983 to 1991, I was the manager in charge of Point Four Hotel. Then I came back to Accra in 1991. I briefly worked with Dimples Inn, also a hotel, for 3 months. Then I got enlisted into the Ghana Prison Service from April to August 1991. I was at a training school. I passed that in August. My first station was James Ford Female Prison. Then I was transferred to the headquarters. Mr. Speaker, Mr. Chairman, between 1991 and 2000, while serving as a prison officer, I decided to climb the educational ladder again because I realized that my mates had gone ahead and I wanted to bridge the gap. So I actually sat in my armchair at home in 1994 and did my A levels. I registered with the Workers' College. Then in 1996, I was offered admission to pursue a diploma program at the Ghana Institute of Journalism, and I majored in public relations and marketing. Right from GIJ, I went back to GEMPA to pursue a postgraduate certificate program in public administration. Then I went ahead to do a marketing program with the Chartered Institute of Marketing in UK. I did the certificate level in 2000. Then I went ahead to do the advanced certificate level. I went ahead to do the postgraduate. So currently, as I speak, I have my master's in marketing. I have my master's in public relations from the Ghana Institute of Journalism. I'm pursuing a third master's program with the University of Leicester, which is an online program. I should have finished in December last year, but because of the elections, I couldn't submit my assignments on time. So I've had to join the October cohort to finish. Mr. Speaker, in 2000, I resigned from the prison service. And in 2002, I was elected as an assembly member for Lako electoral area in the Ladikotopon constituency. I served the assembly for 8 years. My first term was between 2002 to 2006. I was the chairperson for development planning subcommittee of the assembly. Between 2006 and 2008, I served as the chairperson for women and children subcommittee of the assembly. Mr. Speaker, I went back to the Tano North constituency to contest for the primaries. I did contest for 3 times. I didn't give up. I won after the 3rd time to represent the good people of Tano North in 2013. That was in the 6th Parliament. In the 6th Parliament, I served on the Communications Committee, Youth and Sports Committee, and Government Assurances Committee. I sought for re-election, and the good people of Tano North gave me the mandate again in 2016, December. Then I came to the 7th Parliament. Currently, I serve on the Mines and Energy Committee, and I serve on the Government Assurances Committee as well. Mr. Chairman, I've also undertaken some short courses with Harvard University. I've also taken short courses with IP3. I've done 3 programs. I'm yet to do the final one where I'll be certified as a PPP regulator. Mr. Speaker, I love sports. I love watching movies. I love dancing. And I love cooking.
Thank Chairman, you. Which of the dances? Adwa, Agbaja.
I dance Adwa Kete very well.
Old school.
My mother was a queen mother. My big sister sitting right behind me is currently the country hima of Dian Kwanta. She succeeded my mom. So we're brought up in the traditional way.
Your sister says you like Azonto. Is that the case?
Surprising. I love dancing, but I don't know how to dance Azonto. I love high life. I love country music as well. Very cool. And I love dancing. I love my Saturdays when I'm free. I do a lot of dancing around.
Okay.
Very well, though. If there are any questions on the CV, you may ask them now. Yes, Noble Kujeta Blako.
Thank you very much, Chairman, and congratulations.
Thank you.
Honorable FREDA PREMPEH. I have been looking at your profile as we have on your CV and what you presented to Parliament. I'm seeing a few issues that I want you to help us clarify. On the parliamentary website, you indicated that you are also pursuing a PhD business administration at the Ghana Telecom University College, but that disappears from your CV. Any particular reason for that?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. In the first place, I wanted to shorten my educational background and that of the CV as well. I just started my PhD program with the Ghana Telecom University of College, PhD in Business Administration, and I'm trying to research into the impact of low representation of women in Ghanaian politics. I started only in September. It's a very relaxed program. I attend lectures once a week on Saturdays. After a second thought, I didn't add it secondly because I told myself that when I'm giving the nod, I would have to see through my workload if I can continue with it. If I can't, I will defer it. That's why I didn't add it.
Yes, I mean, so, Chairman, the nominee will be a student deputy minister. We encourage you, having considered your background from those humble beginnings to the pride of MP and deputy minister, and probably your own test of in academia, you are looking at low representation of women in politics. You are a fine example of it. And therefore, if you can slow down on the academic and give priority to public service, that would be worthwhile. So just a point of for us to note, I don't have much on the CV, except again that there is no certainty in terms of start of dates, the January's. we are particular about the distinction between Sixth Parliament and Seventh Parliament, when the other came to a terminal end and when the sunset was on with the takeoff of the other. So just take note.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well noted.
I also notice, as we continue, email addresses are different, and also you indicated here that you were separated, marital status separated, but on your CV you have married now. Is it a recent marriage?
Just tell her, you found new love.
Yes, I have. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Have you found anything to clarify on the CV?
Yes.
Let's do that and leave the website to it.
Yes. It's all part of the due diligence and background checks that we do. Page 2 of your CV, we will be interested in the states, the particular states and cities where you did these short courses. You only have United States of America. Are you able to provide that now? You want to give that to us later?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I did it in Arlington, Virginia.
Your employment history. You have entered Lako Electoral Area, Accra Metropolitan Assembly, Assembly Member, 2002 to 2010. Will you define that as employment? Will you define being Assembly Member as employment?
Yes, so Mr. Chairman, because maybe it's because I wasn't working at the time, so it was a full-time job for me. An Assembly Member's job is really a 24/7 job. It's not something you can do on the other side if you really want to excel. Thank you.
Did that as a part-time work. I was working full-time as a lawyer and then part-time as assemblyman for Brookfield Electoral Area at Bekwai. If you have time, they'll give you all the assignments they don't have people to do, but if you're busy, they understand that you come to assembly meetings and continue.
Chairman, but for Frida, that has been helpful surviving internal nerve constraints. So she better not complain about being an assemblywoman. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I really enjoyed serving as an assemblywoman, and that has really built me up to this level. I appreciate what I went through. Thank you.
Do you have any explanation for the 2010 to 2013 gap that we see on your CV? There is a gap, a three-year gap, 2010 to 2013. Are you able to help us with what you were engaged in that period?
Mr. Speaker, I was busily putting myself ready campaigning for the 2013 elections. Thank you.
Full-time campaigner. National Reconciliation Commission, I want you to help me. I thought that this was in the first term of President Kufuor's tenure. You have here February 2006 to November 2006, Public Affairs Officer. Am I missing something, please?
No, I worked with the National Reconciliation Commission as a Public Affairs Officer for a short time, about 8 months before I left.
Yeah, but a year, I thought it was in the first term, between 2002 to 2004. But you have on the CV 2006, February 2006 to November 2006. Did you intend to write 2004? Are you sure about the year? Because I thought that the report was presented sometime in 2004.
No, Mr. Chairman, I'm correct because I have a certificate to that. I was given a certificate. So I can check from the certificate.
Please check that. Take a second look at that. I know the National Reconciliation Commission finished its work in the first term. Page 4 of your CV, we will seek your permission to amend the following tertiary students confederacy of MPP. You left that out. We need the duration for your MPP campaign communication committee. President and founder, Women Supporter Union of Ghana. We believe it's supporters union. And you don't provide a year. You may want to help us with that as well.
Mr. Chairman, I founded the Supporters Union in 2005. We're basically in Germany to support the Black Stars in 2006. And when I became a member of parliament, I left it with the other executives to continue with it. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, that's revealing. You were part of the famous German delegation to support the Black Stars. Obi Amwa was the chief organizer in that. Final page of your CV, we will amend regulatory systems accordingly. Sometimes you say distant learning, sometimes you use distance learning. We believe it should be distance, so we'll correct that. The referees, the first referee, Right Honorable Mike Aaron Okwe, he spells his Okwe without a C, so we will correct that accordingly so that we will not be in contempt of parliament. You know the speaker is already looking for some of us, so we'll correct that accordingly. That was on a lighter note. Mr. Chairman, I'm done with the
I'm glad you acknowledge that was a lighter note. So let the record reflect that it was a lighter note, because it could be a very serious challenge. Any more questions on the CV?
No, substance.
Let's start straight away. I know ranking member wants to start and leave, so I'll give him the chance.
Chairman, is to join you in congratulating Freda Prempeh. She will be working with the Honorable Atakia, who has demonstrated some determination to fix some of the problems relative to the works and housing challenges of the new administration. Once the nominee, I haven't seen Professor Amia Ekumfi, except when we crisscross as he was traveling, mobilizing for campaign 2016. And since this is the first time I'm seeing him accompany a nominee, and he was very gracious to me as a young minister then, when I had to face the appointment committee. So out of grace and respect for Professor Amia Ekumfi and my young full friend, I wish you well. I don't intend to ask you any question than to wish you very well. But to support your minister, that there are challenges in the sector. Workers cannot access cheap and affordable housing. Open drainages remain a challenge, but I know you are not the sector-specific minister, but trust that you partner the minister to do your best in getting an improvement for it. I'm very particular about housing for the judiciary and getting allocations that support the delivery of justice. So since the good old professor was very kind to me, I'll extend same courtesy and kindness to you. And I know your passion when I accompanied you to Yamfu to support vocational training and education for young people in that constituency. And the chief of Yamfu was very kind and generous to me. So out of that, Chairman, you see today I've surprised you. So I'll yield to other colleagues who want to ask questions. I thank you, Chairperson. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
This is a day the Lord has made, and we should rejoice in it. We should rejoice in it. Hello, Patricia PJ.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Honorable Frida, congratulations. Honorable. Going through your CV, I noticed that you worked with the prison services. You know, prison has not been a very pleasant place for anybody to be, We know that we have a number of challenges over there. So I would be very happy if you can give us a brief of your experiences at the prison service. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I've always told myself that we cannot all sit in our air-conditioned offices and be very comfortable. Some of us would have to sacrifice to contribute our quota to the safekeeping of prisoners and reform them and rehabilitate them where practicable. I took that challenge because I also wanted to contribute my quota to the safekeeping of prisoners. Mr. Chairman, it will interest you to know that if you open one prison establishment, wouldn't be sitting here comfortably. Prison officers go through a lot of challenges, and we don't have any other source of income apart from our scanty salary. We have challenges with accommodation, our welfare, transportation. Everything is about the prison officer. The police officer only does the arrest. He keeps the remand prisoner in the police station. He takes him to court, and when he's put on remand, he's sentenced to convicted. They bring him or her to the prison establishment, and you become the number one enemy of the convicted prisoner. He or she forgets that you did not take him or her to court and didn't convict him. So it's a big challenge, especially for a female officer working in female prisons where you have female prisoners with babies, pregnant women who don't even have families to follow up on them. There are times we go the extra mile to support them from our own resources. So it's been a challenge, and I hope going to the Works and Housing Ministry, I would put in a word for the Ghana Prison Service. We can redevelop some of our flats, some of our houses. I was in Block B, which is close to the headquarters. I lived in a single room, very small room, and the kitchen, toilet, and bath were downstairs because it was built in during the colonial era. We can pull some of these structures down, find some resources, go into PPP, and see how best we can put up very comfortable accommodation for the Ghana Prison Service, and for that matter, for all the security services. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Honorable, the rains are here with us. And as a country, yes, I want to find out. I overheard your minister indicating some huge amount of money that will be required to ensure that we'll experience flood-free period in this particular season. What alternative plans would you assist your minister with if we are short of that kind of funding? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I overheard Honorable Obi Amua telling you that you should not remind me of my past, the June 3rd disaster. I was there, and I nearly lost my life. By the grace of God, I survived. Mr. Chairman, Ghana as a country, I think we have a big challenge on our hands. And our problem starts with planning. We wait for the rains to set in. We go around and desilt our gutters. We leave the debris on the banks. It washes back into the gutters. Our gutters are not covered. Our gutters keep on choking. The way we litter around, I think it boils down to education. We have to start with that right from the basics. I remember quite recently when I was traveling to Kumasi, I was at the airport. There was this young lady who had just come from the US with a 5-year-old daughter. The daughter requested for water. And when the woman opened the lid of the bottle, he just threw it on the floor. But the young girl told the mommy that you can't do that. And as a Ghanaian, she said, for us, same free miso. But the little girl picked up the lid, drank the water, and was looking for a dustbin to go and dump it in. If you don't start inculcating that kind of habit in our young people, we'll keep on desilting our gutters and they'll keep on choking. Some people even park refuse in their car and they look left or right and dump it. So until such time that we all agree that it is not right, and that for that matter, the right thing should be done, we'll not be making any headway. But as the rains are so close, my minister, like you rightly said, is so passionate that this time around, we should not experience what we experienced a year or two ago. So I saw the mayor of Accra, the NADMO people. My minister has also put together a team. They are going around to ensure that all our primary and secondary drains are cleared, are desilted, and we find ways and means of covering our gutters as well, because if we don't cover the gutters, we will not be making any headway. So yes, it's a serious challenge, but I believe we all have to change our attitude towards the way we litter around. That is also a contributing factor, and we need to expand our drains, we need to desilt our drains, we need to cover our drains. Our storm drains is also a major problem.
Communications person, please.
Thank you.
Answers can be shorter. If you're going to save time for all of us, make your answers crisp and straight to the point. Okay. You have done two already. Yes, that will be enough. Hey, Kwate, you have come. All right, I'll give you a come.
Thank you very much. Honorable Freda Nanafrewo Prempeh, congratulations.
Thank you, my brother.
Mr. Chairman, I want to encourage my sister, my friend, my colleague, that we've known ourselves for quite a long time, and I know your passion, your respect to humanity, and your humility. I want to urge you to continue and to justify the confidence the president has in you. All I want to tell is that I wish you well, you will succeed, and you have my support. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Honorable Obiamwa.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Honorable Frida, congrats. The powerful founder of Women Supporters Union, Usuga.
Adeshima.
Well, I want to talk about affordable housing. The MPP manifesto talks about sociable or affordable social housing. And it also talks about constraints. What is affordable social housing? And what are the constraints to housing Ghanaians?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, with my interaction with the ministry and what I've read, I've come to realize that we, as a country, have a housing deficit of about 1.7 million. The Akufo administration, in his bid to support public servants with affordable housing projects, started the Pong housing project, the Bote Mine, the Sokori Mampong, Awa, and Tamale. Before the MPP left office, some of the housing projects were up to about 60 or 70% complete. Some of the constraints that we have in this country is the fact that we don't have a national housing authority. The National Housing Policy was launched in 2015, and my minister is so passionate to work on the policy so that we have a national housing fund and have in place the National Housing Authority. Currently, as it stands now, a lot of private developers have problems with land, acquisition of land, credit to acquisition of land, and access to credit is also a problem. A land acquisition is a problem, and even accessibility is a problem. Getting papers for your land is also a problem, the bureaucratic nature that you have to go through and all that. So these are some of the constraints. That's why my minister, during his vetting, said he was going to ensure that all the old affordable housing projects are completed before he embarks on new ones. During the 2000, the Akufo administration, the affordable housing project, I saw it as an affordable housing project because the one-bedroom unit at the time was going for 12,000. And at the time, the dollar rate was one Ghana cedi to one. So it was like $12,000. The two-bedroom house was going for 25,000. But currently, I've been told that the ministry have all handed over some of the housing projects to SNATE to complete. And I've been briefed that the 12,000 units for the one bedroom is now going for 175,000. And the two bedroom is going for 220,000, which I see it's no more affordable. And it looks like certain infrastructure, the sewage, so many things have been incorporated in the cost. So I would advise my minister to look into the MOU again and advise and see how best we can make housing projects affordable to young people of this country. Thank you.
Well, thank you. As a follow-up, you've chipped in funding for housing. What do you think are the practical issues we should address if indeed we can provide funding for housing for the average person, not those in the upper class?
Mr. Speaker, currently under the Ministry of Works and Housing, they have a housing loan scheme for public servants. But it looks like we've not educated ourselves on it so much, so people are not even abreast with it. So without housing loan, public servant can source for funding to either complete their houses or start a new project. Apart from that, my minister also talked about our former Bank for Housing and Construction, which is no more. But I believe that with the Ghana Home Loans, with the HFC and other banks like Cal Bank, and in collaboration with the ministry, we can find a way of getting people access credit to facilitate their projects. And my minister is very passionate about that. Thank you.
Very well. Honorable Samuel Okudzeto.
Most grateful, Mr. Chairman, and congratulations once again, Honorable FREDA
Thank you, Honorable Okudzeto. Mr. Chairman.
My very, very good friend. My first question will be on affordable housing for nurses, teachers, civil servants. And also civil servants who work within the government agencies and departments in Accra. What will be your strategy that you hope to bring to bear as you assist the minister in addressing the issue of affordable houses for these key workers, teachers, nurses, civil servants, and also civil servants in the face of the Accra redevelopment program, which increasingly we are seeing that all the land available in prime areas is being given out to private developers for private housing for those, and really they are, you can't afford it. You can't afford houses in cantonments, Laboni, airport residential, if you are not within a certain, you know, income bracket. Meanwhile, the people we need to service the ministries, the ministers, the civil servants, have to be close to the ministries, departments, and agencies. So affordable housing, and then also good location, prime location, protecting land to develop affordable houses for civil servants who work within these enclaves. What will be your strategy?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. If we talk about affordable housing, then we should be talking about affordable building materials as well. So I would consult, I would suggest to my minister that we should also be looking at our local materials. Where I come from, Tanono District, Tanoso, we have a lot of clay. So the real estate developers around that area are using bricks to build. So their houses are more affordable than those of us in Accra. With the nurses and teachers, since they are organized groups, I think we'd have to do some collaboration with the sector agencies and come out with a program that would help them. Thank you. Well, the prime lands, we are redeveloping them. Some private investors have gone there. But you always have to cut your quota according to your size. And some of the real estate developers are also going to the outskirts. A lot of people are building around Pram Pram or Yarifa, and even Ebri. So if you decide or choose to be in cantonments, maybe you would have assessed yourself to ensure that you can make ends meet. Because under normal circumstances, even if you're renting a house, Under normal international standards, you should not be paying more than 30% of your monthly salary. So if you assess yourself and you can pay from what you have, then that's it's your individual decision. Thank you.
Chairman, my final question. I will seek permission to deviate from housing, because reading up on the nominee, I came across a very interesting news item. 9th March 2015, you called for a new law to compel boys to marry pregnant girls, because the boys leave the girls in school and they continue to become big, big men in society, as you put it, and the girls are left stranded. Do you still hold that view, that we need a new law to compel boys to marry girls? And why did you say that?
Mr. Speaker, Mr. Chairman, where I come from, especially Brahafo region, and for that matter, my constituency, the level of teenage pregnancy is on the ascendancy. Child labor is also a problem. Early child marriage is another problem. The poverty line is another problem. I made that suggestion, and I still stand by it, because I don't see why, as a father, you should go and impregnate your daughter or somebody of your daughter's age. So if you pass a law that says that if you impregnate somebody's child, you have to marry her, then when they are going, they'll take a second look and think about it. I wasn't even emphasizing on the young men, but I've been talking about the old men who can be their fathers and their grandfathers. Why should you lure this young girl? Because she's coming from a very poor background. Get her pregnant and leave her to abandon school. And the future of the unborn baby, the future of that child is at stake. So that's why I said, there's a young girl who lives behind my house in Duan Quanta. She got herself pregnant at the age of about 14. And it was so pathetic, we had to help her out. And somewhere along the line, by 15, she had another one. You know, so if you don't put those people to book, if the law doesn't say anything, people will keep on impregnating young people and they go scot-free. I think something has to be done about it.
Was she a victim of rape?
It wasn't a rape, I think it was not by consensus though, because she was below the age of 15.
I agree to the extent that people should take responsibility, but first thing is that a person is below 40, at 14, that's a crime, and that we should look at the boy as having committed a crime. So all of us as a community, we are hypocrites. We ourselves will go and negotiate behind the scenes. Even when the matter is in court, we find a way to bring it out and negotiate the thing. So the real issue we should be focusing is how do we ensure that girl, even if she gives birth, she goes back to school to build a career for her. For me, that's where your advocacy should be going. And as for marriage, by law, I can marry you today and divorce you tomorrow. I would have fulfilled my promise. So let's not go there. How do we help that young girl to get back to society, to finish her schooling or learn a trade so she can be useful to herself? But I like your boldness in making that decision. Well, so let's go. Honorable, I was going to mention the other one, Anthony Cabo.
Please do. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I would like to congratulate the nominee, Madam Freda Prempeh, very active personality within the New Patriotic Party, especially in the women's wing. Congratulations once again. My question has to do with the high attrition rate at which government buildings are deteriorating, and the fact that the Public Works Department, which falls directly under your ministry, appears to have been abandoned. And it is the reason why many of these government buildings are eventually written off and sold to private people. What are you going to do to help your minister so that the PWD, the Public Works Department, can be revamped so that the maintenance culture of public buildings can be strengthened?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. PUWD is a very good institution, agency that was set up during the colonial era. It's been with us for the past 122 years. In those days, PUWD was very vibrant. Unfortunately, they've decentralized. So the MMDs, the district assemblies, have taken over the works departments, and the district engineers are supervising works at the district level, and the regional coordinating council also supervising work at the regional level. So what is left with the PWD now is only the regional office in Accra and the prestige office. And they are doing some bit of consultancy. They are also manning some of our agencies. They are manning the audio department of the Accra International Conference Center, the National Theater, the Foreign Affairs Ministry. But I think they're also under-resourced, as my minister said during his vetting. So we're going to see how best we can rejuvenate PWD. But they can also be innovative and a bit creative to also find, to generate some resources for themselves, because they even have a plot of land, a massive one, close to the electricity area, close to Makola, where they can put up a very huge building for commercial purposes. That is also sitting there. They are manning the Accra International Conference Center. The Accra International Conference Center is more or less a commercial entity now, but yet they are not paying any bits, any percentage of what they make to the PWD. So I think it's about how we can restructure PWD for them to retain some of their monies at that level and resource them to work effectively. But talking about a culture of maintenance, I think we all as individuals and Ghanaians have a role to play. Once you live in a government bungalow, you tend to overlook certain things. But if you are living in your own house, you not sit down for the house to deteriorate. When I was at the prison service and living in the barracks, I was keeping my room within my block. And when I even went to the extent of tiling my bathhouse, my colleagues were like, it's about time that we as individuals, we maintain the homes that we live in.
We want you to translate for us,
Mr. Chairman, it basically means that this is a government property, so why do you worry yourself in tiling the bathhouse? But that is where I lived, and that was my identity. So if you have that habit, if you cultivate that attitude that it's my own, so I'll keep it well, it will go a long way to help all of us. And I think that I would also suggest to my minister that henceforth, we should find a way of letting occupants of government bungalows put down some money. In the developed countries, even in the US, if you go and rent a house, you are made to put down 1 month of the rent advance to cater for some of these maintenance. So if you are leaving the premises and you've not incurred any problem, they refund your money back to you. But in our part of the world, because we are not committed to any kind of that, anything of that nature, we tend to overlook things. So our maintenance culture, we have to have a maintenance policy and see how best we can address it, making sure that occupants of government bungalows and offices also have a role to play in maintaining our government houses. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Madam Nominee, I know you very well. I know you're a very strong and passionate person. But you are going to be working with a male minister, coupled with your colleague deputy, who is also a male and a very strong character as well. Can you just tell this committee about your leadership style, your temperament, and how you are going to manage working in the midst of all these very opinionated personalities? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I believe in participatory leadership. I'm very affable. I'm a down-to-earth person. I believe in knowledge sharing. I believe in dialogue and compromise. And I believe that with all this, I know my minister, I've had a personal interaction with him for a long time, and I hope I'll be able to work with him, because he knows me very well, and I know him very well. I don't have any problem. I'm a very affable person, you know me. Thank you very much.
Honorable, hello.
Thank you, Chair, and I also want to add my voice to several voices I have congratulated and also acknowledge your skills and your strong nature, which we hope you bring to bear on your work, and wish you all the best. I have only one question for you, and that is about the rent control units. They appear to be very weak, under-resourced, understaffed, and because of these, people who patronize their services are left to suffer a lot. I've known people who have spent months going to the rent control because they have been ejected unlawfully, or the landlord decides to, or landlady, let me use both, decides to increase rent arbitrarily and all that. What is your plan, and what would you advise your minister to do to revamp the rent control units so that the poor can live peacefully where they are, even if they don't have access to the, you know, the new buildings that we're putting up? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The Rent Control Act 220, which was promulgated in 1963, is being reviewed. Landlords are just abusing it because it looks like most of them are not even conversant with their laws. So they take rent advance depending on the nature of the building and where it's sited. But the Rent Act says you cannot take more than 6 months rent advance. But yet people go to the extent of taking 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, and even some in dollars. So right now the Rent Control Act is being reviewed. They are advocating that we extend the 6 months to 1 year, which will be comfortable for both landlord and tenants. The rent control officers indeed are not resourced well, but they are still working very hard to ensure that we have sanity within the system. And it will interest you to know that last year they were able to solve about 20,000 out of 26,000 cases. They are not resident in all the regions. And once the Rent Control Act is being reviewed, we'll take care of some of these issues to resource them for them to work much better. Thank you.
Okay, I will have the last bite. I'm taking on from where my available leader left off. We have discussed the problem of affordable housing, and the definition of affordable today is an issue. If we're going by the figures you mentioned of the current rate of the affordable housing, you and I cannot afford it. 170 something thousand Ghana cedis for a 2-bedroom unit. Many of us cannot afford it. Would you consider investing in rental units rather than purchasing? Because it's everybody who can own a house, but at least everybody should be able to afford to pay a rent. What do you think about rental units rather than affordable housing, as in purchasing for yourself?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's the MPP's, or for that matter, Nanado Dankwa's vision to ensure that especially young people get access to affordable housing units. They can also have money to rent as well. We can only have good rentals where we have affordable housing projects. So that's what we'll be looking at, using local materials to build modest homes for our young people. And if we don't review the Rent Act, and then people have to pay the 1 year and the more than they are paying as it is now, we'll not be making any headway. So we have a starting point. The starting point is to ensure that you have a real quality, affordable, modest house for young people where they can rent and pay 30% out of their salaries and still be comfortable. Thank you.
Okay, I wish you well. The Chief Whip will give us the list. Your list is very tall. We advise you to invite only 10 people. Now, your list alone suggests about 30 something, is that right?
25.
The chairman, it shows the kind of love my people from Tano North
constituency. It shows that all of us do not obey regulations.
Oh,
that is all.
Some came on their own.
The chairman has sanctioned the list, so I'm going to mention everybody's name. Mr. Alex Akufu is the spouse of the nominee. Honorable Professor Christopher Amiyao Akumfi, former MP, former minister. Nana Ama Echa Prempeh is a sister of the nominee and the Kruntihima of Duyayankwanta. Nana Ochri Jauhini Ankobiahini Duyayankwanta. Nana Opon Bwachi Sanahini Duyayankwanta. Nana Bonin Nkrairi Afisipahini. Nana Aprakudate Chidomhini.